本期节目由红警 OL 手游冠名播出，军略对抗，进化重燃，玩红警 OL 手游，用现代战争策略做最强指挥官。
军武大本营，张老师，我们今天从军武大本营的演播室穿越到了碟中谍。待会儿我们就会有三位主创过来跟我们一起聊聊。我们都知道碟中谍六它必定是大片无疑了，但一说到大片，其实大家更多的是讲哇，这部片特技做得特别的棒，3D CG 这些东西。但是这部片我觉得它特别的地方是在于它其实特技没有那么的多，它基本上从头到尾各种各样的大场面都是由汤姆克鲁斯还有其他的演员亲自去完成的。
这在中国观众来讲，他们就认为脑子有病。现在科学技术发展这么快了，对不对？你说汤姆克鲁斯，我是今年66，汤姆克鲁斯比我正好小10岁。
56了也。
56岁的人，说那么多特技动作，你有什么必要呢？后期贴着绿幕自己在那抠像多好呢。找替身自己做一下，看不到脸就可以替身开摩托打斗都可以，他都是自己完成的，有什么必要呢？所以说我们大家看完了之后要思考一个问题，为什么美国人这么一根筋，有替身不用啊，绿幕抠像也不用，这就是他们发明的他还不用啊。高空跳伞非得正儿八经的跳，比那个正儿八经的特种队员跳的还多啊，他这么样究竟追求一个什么样的目的？
其实我看的时候那个版本是没有做完的，
我也是看的那个，
你也是看那个。你会看到汤姆克鲁斯比如说他挂在悬崖上的时候，他身上有两根绳子而已，就是两根绳子，然后他在那个电梯里边的时候有一场戏的时候，他也就是一根绳子挂着他，他就真的掉在那个半空中。过去可能我看这些特别精彩镜头的时候，我都不会太有时间去想说这个镜头是怎么完成的，可是当你真的看到啊，就是两根绳子挂在那儿，这么大的明星啊，世界级的明星就真的被挂在那个悬崖上，他不怕掉下去吗？
那个绳子是确保他生命安全的。
嗯，
对他做动作没有任何的辅助作用，
没有。
所以说呢，你看完我也是看了那个二维的，那后期没有合成，就感觉什么叫伟大的演员，什么叫为艺术而献身，所有的东西都是追求那样的真。
在专访开始以前，先见见局座口中这位伟大的演员吧。作为志愿者，我将在汤姆克鲁斯的指导下进入风洞，体验单人跳伞的感觉。看得出来阿汤哥是真心很嗨跳伞呀，在现场他跟大家分享了很多跳伞的经验。
真的准备好了吗？
How does it feel?
A little something.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it?
Yes,
you're using different muscles. You know that you're not normally used to using.
Yes.
And it takes a little bit to feel it. It was when I was training in the skydiving, and I was also training for the fight training at the same time, for the fight, for the bathroom fight, and for the VIP room. And actually,it was hard because I had to stop doing the skydive training at that point because it was my back was getting so tight.
And the running too.
That's right, the running.
Sprinting was a different set of muscles.
That's right, different set of muscles. So it was very hard. You're right, for the sprint training, it was very hard to do my sprint training while I was doing this also.
So
you feel your back a little bit, don't you?
It's
normal. It's normal. That's very normal that you're feeling. Just know.And when I was, you know, you had to really build up to doing that a lot. When we were in Abu Dhabi, you know, I was there for about a week before most of the crew came, just trying to build my body up and train for that altitude and that many jumps a day. And each jump, it was like running a full sprint, you know, an 800 meter sprint. It was grueling doing it. A lot of fun, but very, very intense.
可惜阿汤哥身上有伤不能一起飞，但在进入风洞前他一直提醒我们先戴耳塞再戴头盔，免得噪音伤害耳朵，还示意我们把衣服拉链拉到底，避免风灌进去，可以说是非常细心和专业了。 亲身体验了一把风洞，比想象中更有挑战。其实最后我是在半空中打了个滚，然后直接就摔了下来，这也让我更加意识到电影中那些动作是有多难。带着对拍摄过程的强烈好奇，赶快来跟主创们好好聊聊吧。
梁亨林你好，就是我看到你本人比镜头上要强壮多了。
昨天我们观影啊，有一帮小姑娘，这个他们说，哇，这个说是你留着胡子比这样子更帅，今天刮胡子了，今天。
哦，哇，OK。
你知道在中国你是超级大帅哥啊。
所以这次能够加入到《碟中谍》这个系列，就是你以前有没有想过你自己会参与拍摄这部影片？
I honestly, it was, for me, I wasn't ever expecting to play a character like this. I never like to say that I'm not going to play characters like this. And for me, when I got the call from Chris McQuarrie, I was more excited than anything. I thought it was such a wonderful opportunity to play an ambiguous character like this.And also be involved in a movie with so many practical stunts and practical locations, which is different from some of the other movies I've done recently.
就是在那个 C17 环球霸王往下跳的时候，出现了那个氧气管儿啊，那样的一种事件。你是跳了多少次？经过很多很多次的训练才能拍成那样子？你要知道，咱两个人在空中，如果说一个。人跳伞会去接触到另外一个人，这个时候是非常危险的。
It's very, very dangerous. Unfortunately, I wasn't even allowed to do that stunt. That's how dangerous it was. I was requesting to do it from the very beginning of the movie, and by the very end of the movie, when we were shooting it, I said to Tom, let me jump. I've had time in the wind tunnel, like sort of, come on, I'm here, I'm ready, put me in. And unfortunately,Tom then turned around to me and said, look, I completely understand how you're feeling. I would feel the exact same way. But if you do jump, you'll probably kill all of us because you need hours of training in the air. And especially with an oxygen exchange as well, it's very important that you have the right training. And that collision they do requires a lot of skill to be able to pull out of it. And if I wasn't doing it properly, even if Tom was doing it perfectly and I wasn't doing it properly,It could end up being a fatal spin, and we both hit the ground.
我想听一下你跳伞的感受，大约在多高的高度，你感觉自己会缺氧，或者是寒冷，很寒冷。
The altitude was the funniest thing for me, because we were on the ground in Abu Dhabi, and it was very hot in the aircraft, and before you do a halo jump, you have to free breathe oxygen for pure oxygen on the ground for a pre-breathe, they call it, for half an hour. So your body gets used to it, you have lots of oxygen in the blood, and then because the plane isn't pressurized like a commercial jet, and you go up so very quickly, everything in the body expands, and it feels incredibly uncomfortable. And you feel like you need to go to the bathroom.Because everything just starts to swell and swell and swell, and you're very uncomfortable. You feel like you want to burp and everything, and you just want to jump out of the plane, to be honest. And it has a very, very strange effect on the body going up like that, especially time after time after time. And we got drilled a lot on, we were told and trained a lot on what would happen if we, I forget what they call it now, off the top of my head, but it's when you lose oxygen. You start acting almost drunk, and then you'll take sort of your breathing apparatus off, and then you can die. You can die in those very moments. And so it was potentially very dangerous. We had a wonderful medic on board who was keeping a sharp eye on us and checking us and talking to us all the time. But it was a very strange experience to feel everything swell inside when you're going up so quickly. It wasn't very comfortable.
我印象很深的还有一些别的场面的戏，比如说直升机的那个追逐的那个场面。当时你也是在直升机上拍摄吗？那你自己是不是在之前也要先提前训练很久才可以去拍？
Thankfully, I didn't have to fly the helicopter. That was up to Tom in his helicopter to fly the helicopter. I was riding in mine, so mine was all about performance. The trickiest thing for me was the temperature. because, yes, exactly, a lot of that. Because we're above the mountains in New Zealand in winter, it's minus 15 degrees centigrade up there. It's incredibly cold. And my costume isn't designed for that kind of cold, nor for 2 weeks of going up seven times a day for an hour every day, every trip. And so it was about 7 hours a day in this extreme cold weather. And that for me was the most uncomfortable thing. And also I couldn't hear anything. I had no direction. I had to guess when everything was happening. They would tell me what was happening before we went up. And then it was just guessing what Tom was doing. Thankfully, Tom was so close to my helicopter that I could see his face and I could read his intention. And so I knew what to do, whether I'd go from side to side. I knew if he was about to do this, and so I could jump to the other side of the helicopter or vice versa. But it was definitely a tricky experience, not being able to hear anyone and just guessing what was going on while it was freezing cold up in the mountains.
Tom 真的是飞机是他开的吗？
Absolutely, yes. Yes, Tom flew it all himself.
最后在那个悬崖上打斗那一个，最后他那个往上爬那一块，是他真的是往上爬的吗？还是绿布抠像？
We both personally did that. Absolutely.
所以那个时候把你吊在那个悬崖上，其实也是很危险的。普通人可能只是站在那里都已经觉得很害怕了。你当时会觉得很害怕吗？
Heights aren't a big fear for me. I mean, it's certainly, there's obviously when you, I'm more worried about hitting the ground than I am falling. Heights aren't so bad. It's getting very close to the ground after being at a very high height shortly before. But for that, because on Pulpit Rock in Norway, which is an amazing location, it was so high that, and we had a special rig up there and everything for safety, and it was still dangerous because the rig could fail, the rig could come off the top of the mountain, but Eastwood Action Stunts did an amazing job making it as safe as possible, and they're such a wonderful team. But it's so high when you look over the edge, it's 1,800 feet to the bottom, that it doesn't look like a drop. It looks like a painting. It looks like a fall up to a certain place, and then it just looks like a beautiful painting. And so your brain does other things with it. It doesn't ever imagine that you would ever fall. And if you were to fall, you think that you can fly or something because it's just that far away. It's a very strange experience.
那个你们在打斗的那个平台，那个悬崖上面那个平台有多大呀？有这种房子这么大？
That platform was probably the space we were fighting, maybe twice the size of this, sort of another bit of space that way. Yeah, but it went back another two times as well. It's not very big. In real life, when you're there, there's a lot of places to fall off.
那这么高，1,700米的这么高度，那个真的会很危险，有可能把你们吹下去的。
It was surprisingly dangerous. The weather was incredibly bad. We had 3 days of we couldn't shoot, and then we had 3 days we could shoot. And on the end of the very last day, they were saying the weather's moving in, and we had to get up there with helicopters every time. And I remember thinking, why is everyone panicking? Like, we're not going to not get out of here. We'll be fine. Like, there may be a bit of weather, we'll wait, and then the weather will pass, and then we can leave. And it starts snowing by the time we leave. And so then I hear about a month later, they say, oh yeah, you know when it started snowing? It never stopped after that. They had to leave equipment up there because the snow was up to here. And that was we shot for the last few seconds we could, got on the helicopters and left, and they secured some equipment up there which they couldn't retrieve because it was covered in snow.
下次考古队发现了以后就说，哇，这是原来碟中谍，文物古董。
Yeah, will be the first signs of life that aliens discover on the planet.
是超人留下的。
Exactly. I should have maybe put the S up on the rock there.
而且我还印象很深的是在厕所里边的那段打斗的戏，当时你有几个镜头，哇，也是超级帅的。就您在这些，您是本来就是会一些吗？还是说你要提前先学为了这部戏？
I've done a few movies which have involved some sort of fighting, but on this I learned a lot. I worked with a wonderful fight coordinator by the name of Wolfie Stegerman, and he was very talented and very patient, and we just wanted to give August Walker his own style of fighting to differentiate him from Ethan Hunt even more. I mean, there's a bit of size difference. I have a moustache. I'm a brutal character. And so it was fun to develop that kind of fight style where he is he's so aggressively after the target every time. And then you couple that with Liang Yang's performance and the way he fought and the way he dismantled both August Walker and Ethan Hunt by himself makes the scene both intense and enormous amounts of fun as well.
看完了电影以后啊，我这个出来之后我就去了卫生间，卫生间以后我很警惕地看了看周围有没有人，就在我出来的时候突然进来一个人，我马上就开始模仿你的动作，但是最后还好，没有发现任何事情，
因为你身上没有布单。
Yes, absolutely. You should not be afraid of using the bathroom after watching this movie. It's still perfectly safe. Well, actually, I can't speak for everyone's bathroom, but the bathrooms, which most cinemas, perfectly safe. But yeah, it was a very difficult scene because it was actually painful. Everything we did, we had to sell intensity. And Tom and I, at the very beginning of shooting this four-week scene,would say to each other, you okay and everything? And we said, yeah, no, totally fine. Yeah, totally fine. Good, good. No injuries. No, nothing. By the end of it, we would turn to each other and say, you okay? It's like, yeah, I've been lying for 4 weeks. I'm in so much pain. My elbow hurts, my knees hurt, my back hurts, my ribs hurt. I've got bruises here. I've got bruises. I didn't even know where I could get bruises. And it was just one of those scenes which you play tough from the beginning, but it was so long and so arduous that...By the end of it, we just went, you know what? Yeah, I'm in a lot of pain.
那这么危险又这么多伤痛，有没有想过要找一个替身来帮你完成一些？比如拍不到我的脸，我就可以让一个武术指导帮我去打嘛？为什么不这样？
I took a lot of pride in making my stuntman very bored, my stunt double. We actually still joke about it now, and he's very talented. He knows what he's doing. But it's just one of those things where he didn't get to work a lot in this movie. It was just for me, I take a lot of pride in it, especially in a Tom Cruise movie where he does all his own stunts. I got to do 99% of my stunts, and that was a wonderful opportunity, and I'm very, very happy for it.
是不是在这个拍摄的过程中也带着一种演员之间较量的一种心情？你可以做到的，我也要做到，而且我希望做得更好。会不会有这种感觉
？There's no competition, no. I mean, Tom is always going to do it better because he's Tom Cruise and he's very, very good at this stuff. So there's no competition, but there's definitely a standard set. If when you see someone else doing it, you see someone else going through so much and working so hard, you work to the same level. And Tom sets a wonderful example. He's a good set leader.
你这个戏里面是带着。胡子去表演，这个是什么样的设计呢？你是怎么理解这个形象的？
Well, the moustache was something interesting because first of all, I had a beard from the previous movie, and I was coming straight from that movie. And we said we don't want you to have a beard, but maybe something, but a scruff. And I found this image of a character from a Superman comic. Actually, his name is Elias Orr, and he's a very grey character, very questionable morals, and I thought, you know, there's a cool look to him, it's kind of interesting, it's not quite bad guy, but it's definitely not good guy, and that's the kind of ambiguity I wanted to provide for this character. And I showed Chris McQuarrie, and Chris went, yeah, you know what, we'll try it. I don't think a moustache is going to work, but we'll give it a shot. And then we shaved my beard down just enough to end up with giving me a moustache, and we looked at it, and everyone else looked at it, and we went, huh.Strangely, it kind of works. And eventually we said, yeah, okay, let's stick with it. And that's how the August Walker moustache came about.
看起来比汤姆·克鲁斯还老啊。
Yes. Well, I am actually older than Tom Cruise. And I'm a very wise man.
导演您好，其实我知道就是《碟中谍》这个系列它是有一个规矩吧，就是说每一部的导演都会换不同的人，可是您是唯一的一个指导了第二部的，那当知道这个事情的时候，您是不是会很惊讶？为什么会让您第二次又再次的指导《碟中谍》的系列呢？
Well, it's not that I am the first to be invited back, I'm the first one who's crazy enough to say yes. And it was, but it was a pleasure. It was actually an honor and a little bit of a challenge. I was nervous coming back because I wanted to maintain that tradition. I wanted it to feel like it was a different director. So I had to find a way to reinvent myself and reinvent my style.
所以那这次您做了哪一些突破呢？
Well, the first thing I did was I replaced most of my key crew. I started with a new cinematographer, a new composer, a new production designer. Anybody who would really affect the look and the feel of the film, I started over, which was a very challenging experience because you're working with all new people on what is a very challenging movie. We wanted to make a movie that was more emotional. And that was a little darker and a little harder hitting than the last movie.
我昨天看的电影，看的时候非常的激动。我在想，我们中国什么时候能拍出这种电影来？我是中国的一个军事专家啊，这个研究军事半个世纪了。在1984年的时候，我翻译了 Tom Clancy 先生写的《The Hunt for Red October》，就是我们翻过来叫《追踪红十字号潜艇》。Tom Clancy 他是我崇拜的一个偶像，看完你这个电影之后呢，我就感觉你对军事、对国际的反恐、整个事情的把握都是非常的厉害。我就特别不清楚你是背后有一个团队帮着你提供这方面的咨询顾问，还是你自己就想到这么多事情。而且很厉害的这样的一些技术性的事情。
I think it's probably a mix of the two. I do a fair bit of research, and a fair bit of reading on the subject, and then and what we will do is we'll try not to get too caught up in details like that when we're presenting the story, and then we challenge our crew to come to us with what's real.And so we try to find a careful balance between reality and fiction, only because if we get too technical, it becomes very complicated. And I'm always trying to find ways to convey things emotionally rather than with information.
是，但是在你这个电影里边有很多的技术细节对观众是产生了震撼性的作用，比方说在那个地下车库里边，汤姆·克鲁斯然后要想把那个布袋给他弄到车上去，车距离他很远，这个时候他通过手机遥控车就过来了，这样的一个细节。还有那个脖子里边的微波跟踪器，走到哪里微波就会跟踪定位到哪里啊。还有这个关于布袋的整个的设计，布袋的一直从头到尾布袋是一条主线，我们都知道这个事情会被解除，但是没想到那样的惊心动魄啊！就这个布袋里头牵涉到他和这个布袋，因为他有 X 射线，要和那些医疗队的那些 X 光机搅和的一块，哪哪都测不出来，还乱剪那种各种线啊！最后直升机打斗，很多很多的技术细节，看起来是不经意的，其实背后有很深厚的理论功底和技术功底，我感觉。
Yes, and all of that comes from the need to give all of the characters something vital to do. We started with, when we designed that sequence, we started with deciding which characters were going to be where, and making sure that every single character performed an important function, that if one of them was not there, nothing would have worked. And so everything came from character more than technology, and we let the technology serve that.
我特别好奇啊，就我们的军迷也会非常好奇，就是很多非常精彩的镜头是怎么样拍摄出来的？比如说这个汤姆·克鲁斯他从那个天上跳下来搞高跳低开的那一整组的这个过程，这是怎么拍出来的？因为我们知道光是跳伞本身就是已经很难了。更何况他在跳的过程中还要做很多很多的动作救人，同时镜头又怎么能够拍到这么精确这么好，是这个摄影师是不是也是需要同样的这样非常厉害的这个跳伞的能力？
Well, something like the halo jump, we started with the simplest idea, which was just what the story was. And then, of course, we have our own rules when we're making these films that you have to see Ethan doing it. We try to do things in such a way that that it couldn't just be a stuntman, but you actually see Ethan doing it. And the reason why we do that is not because Tom Cruise is a daredevil, but because we want the audience to feel and share that experience with Ethan. So of course, the first problem that we figured out was, how does the cameraman go out first so that you see Tom's face? That meant the cameraman had to go out backwards. The next complication is that we decided to shoot the sequence at night, which meant that we had to design a helmet that had lights in it so you could see Tom's face. That helmet didn't exist. So we had to build the helmet, we had to build his entire costume, and then we had to shoot it right at dusk. So we only had 3 minutes of available light every day to shoot. And that meant you had one opportunity every day to get the shot. And if you didn't get it, you had to come back the next day. And so all day, Tom would be rehearsing five, sometimes seven jumps until the light was ready. And then we would jump the one time. So altogether, it was 106 jumps before we finished the sequence.
我对军队的跳伞是有研究的，因为它是伞降是特种部队的一个非常重要的一个训练。高空跳伞、低空开伞是为了保全他们自己的生存，防止地面的炮火把它打死。你拍电影从那个 C-17 环球霸王上面跳下来，跳下来之后你可以6000米开伞，让那个摄影师另外一个跳伞的时候可以慢慢的拍摄它。你后期的时候把中间那块剪掉，它就是低空开伞。那你何必训练这么长时间，让汤姆·克鲁斯每天都训练，连续训练好几周，那有什么意思呢？是吧？你6000米跳伞以后，旁边摄影师跟着慢慢拍，落下来以后三五分钟慢慢拍呗。啊，夕阳西下，顺着光以后拍很美的画面，把中间那块都剪掉，给大家误以为突然就低空开伞了，几百米就开伞了。你为什么这么认真呢？
It's a very good question. Tom had to do specific bits of action within that window. And by the time he finished that action, he was usually right at 3,000 feet, which was the minimum minimum distance that we could open the chute. So he would have done it sooner, but he couldn't. We had so much action to do.
是时候表演真正的技术了。
碟中谍六中的阿汤哥挑战了黑楼跳伞，也就是俗称的高跳低开，这让很多朋友都对跳伞产生了兴趣啊。今天真正的技术，我就把年初带小龙女跳伞体验的镜头再重温一次，顺便也讲一下有关黑楼的基础知识，让大家看电影的时候有更大的乐趣。
记住，就是一个要避免很高的建筑物，然后避免像这种交通的道路，尽量的不要去靠近它，想往右转的话，两手是这样落的，然后要斜切，同时眼睛往那边，然后这个时候就会向右转。
我们今天要跳大概4000米的高度，其方式就是所谓的高跳低开，是因为高跳低开的情况下是最便于军事行动的。
黑楼跳伞为的是缩短滞空时间，所以相对军事上的高跳高开，也就是黑后跳伞，落点会更加的精确，而不是经常被人误以为的那种黑楼跳伞其实很难被发现。所以其实黑楼是为了精确度，黑后是为了隐秘性。但不管怎么样，军事上的黑楼与黑后都是夜间进行的，因此存在的风险、操作的难度，不管对飞机驾驶员来说还是对跳伞者来说，都比白天的民间俱乐部跳伞要难得多得多。
待会儿跳出飞机之后，我教大家怎么样操控降落伞，怎么样观察地面，怎么样靠近你的目标。
首先在离开飞机之后你要判断一下自己的高度，当然这是看高度表然后要确定周围有没有其他人，避免跟其他人撞上。在电影中，阿汤哥的队友氧气瓶出现故障，因此阿汤哥要飞到他身边帮助他排除这些故障，这在真实跳伞中是很难做到的，因为被救的那个人已经失去了意识，随气流任意摆动了身体， 而导致下落轨道的不稳定，并且在高速相对风的影响下，去救他的阿汤哥也很难稳定的精确的做出每一个细小的动作，所以说每一次失误都可能导致他们再次分离，使拯救行动前功尽弃。好，言归正传啊，到了这个高度的时候就要检查一下周围有没有人，然后做一些转圈呀、前空翻、后空翻的动作，差不多该开伞的时候要挥手示意其他人躲开一点。好了，开伞，降落伞打开以后呢，首先要狠狠地拉几下刹车，让降落伞充分的充气，然后再看看高度表，轻轻地转一下，确定周围没有其他人的时候，你再狠狠地拉一把刹车，玩一下天旋地转的垂直下降。别忘了整个过程中啊，你随时都要盯紧高度表，并且这个时候应该根据风向和高度来判断你是否能够精确着陆了。我是军吴新雷，会继续教大家一些实用的技能。
关心军事的人一定要关注军武大本营微信公众号，在这里有局座张召忠和各界大咖谈笑风生，有著名军事评论员每日点评最热新闻，还有特种兵吴新雷上天下海，带你了解最专业的军事常识，以及最新最火的各项军事展览盛会，这里都独家全即时报道。现在即刻关注军武大本营微信公众号吧，打开微信，点击右上角加号，选择添加朋友，再选择公众号一栏，输入军武大本营，就能加入我们了。
我们知道就是在这个电影里边有一些原则，比如说不用 CG， 不用抠图，然后不用替身，绝大部分的镜头都是让汤姆·克鲁斯自己去亲自的去完成，为此他还要接受非常多的训练。就为什么要坚持这样？其实很多的大片我们都可以用特效去做到很多让人震撼的镜头，为什么还要坚持亲自去做，然后剧组也要承受非常大的压力和这个成本去拍到这些真实的镜头，这是为什么？
You know, audiences know the difference, whether they're fully aware of it or whether it's something they're feeling subconsciously. There's just a very different experience when you're watching someone do it practically. And because Tom is the one doing it, we're able to shoot it in ways that other films can't. And it just gives you a unique experience that you're not going to get anywhere else.
像汤姆·克鲁斯这样就这么有名气了，他还会亲自去做所有这些特别危险的动作，而且为此要付出大量的时间去练习。这个您觉得是理所应当的吗？您会因为他的年纪也五十多岁了，您会去劝他说不要给自己这么多的挑战，我们用一些后期的方式来掩盖这种前期的一些不足，你会这样去想或者是这样去做吗？
If there was a shot where I couldn't see Tom's face, where there was nowhere where I could put the camera to actually see him doing it, I would discourage him from doing it. Only because he'd be risking an injury for no real benefit. And the only time I've ever talked him out of a stunt was on this movie, when I looked at the stunt compared to everything else we did and said, you know, for all the work we've done, this is kind of boring.And it's not worth the risk. But anything else where the stunt is particularly challenging, he's there. I couldn't stop him if I wanted to.
你能不能分享一件，就是在整个拍摄的整个过程当中，您觉得最难的一刻，或者是最危险的一次经历，一件事情给我们？
Difficult and dangerous are two different answers. All of the sequences were difficult, each in their own way. The helicopter sequence took an incredible amount of training, and we had to develop all the camera equipment. None of it existed. No one had ever shot a sequence that way before. The foot chase in London, which should have been the simplest action sequence, Tom broke his ankle on the first day, so that he was running with a broken ankle throughout the entire chase. The Paris chase sequence, we had those locations.Each one of those locations we only had for a few hours, and that put a lot of time pressure on us. The Halo sequence, where we were shooting for 3 minutes a day. The most dangerous, I would have to say, was the helicopter chase. That is far and away the most nervous I've ever been in all the years I've been working with Tom, mostly because I had to be in the helicopter behind Tom. So I'm not worried about Tom, I'm worried about me.
你有计划再拍下一部吗？如你已经在这一部里边把一切都做到了这么极致，如果再让你拍一部，你还有什么新的办法吗？
Not yet. Yes, the funny thing about Mission Impossible is we never know what we're going to do until we start talking about it. So that's the scariest part of making a Mission Impossible is to say yes to making a Mission Impossible.
It's always a pleasure to be part of these movies.
Relax. I'm relaxed.
You don't sound relaxed.
He sounds terrified.
It's entirely possible to be relaxed and extremely uneasy at the same time.
No, sir.
You do it all the time.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
西门先生您好，您是在已经拍过好几部这个《碟中谍》的系列了，就在这之前您有没有想过自己会拍摄这个电影，然后真正开始拍摄到现在，就是给您最大的一个感受是什么？
No, I didn't realize when I did the first Mission Impossible, my first Mission Impossible, which was Mission Impossible 3, that I would eventually be in 4 of the films. But it's been a real challenge and enormous fun to play a character over such a long period of time and play him, play his evolution from a technical guy in the background to a fully fledged secret agent. So, yeah, it's been a real privilege. I'm glad he's still alive.
我们中国有句话，有的人他在电影里头是颜值担当，你在里头是搞笑担当，专门负责幽默。
对，带给我们特别多的欢笑。嗯，在之前您都是一个技术人员，但这部戏里边您开始有一些动作戏了。那演这个动作戏对你来说是需要经过其他的一些专门的训练吗？对你来说会不会是一个很大的挑战
？Yeah, I mean, I had to get in really good shape for the film, and learn new skills. I had to learn to drive a speedboat, and to use underwater breathing equipment. And I had to train to do a fight sequence, which was quite difficult and painful at times. But it was really good fun, and I really love the challenge of playing a role where you have new skills and get new challenges every day. And Mission Impossible is the best film for that kind of thing.
就是那个在法国拍的时候，阿汤哥跑跑跑跑跑，越跑越跳一草坪里去。我以为他跳草坪周围被包围了，结果下面掉了船里去了。那是真实的法国就是那样的吗？路上就很多那样的，下边就是水的隧道，就真的是很多那种恐
龙。
Oh yeah,
it's that the hole that Ethan jumps down is a real thing in Paris. The canals that run under Paris.There are skylights which punctuate the canal, and they go up into the street. So you could conceivably jump down into a boat.
这个真的，我以为这还被捉了，也就到草坪里去了，四面被围困，都是警察。结果最后好家伙，太好了。
然后看到你的脸忽然出现的时候，哇，觉得好开心啊！所以在这部戏里边，您刚才也讲，你也会接受很多特别的训练。这个训练大概会花多长的时间？大概有一些什么样的项目？对你来说有没有什么特别的难度或者是挑战的部分？
Well, the training is ongoing throughout the whole film. I mean, we keep the fitness training going. And the first thing I did was learn to drive the speedboat on a lake in the UK. And then I went out to Paris and I learned to drive it on the River Seine. And I also went and had lessons in sub-aqua, breathing underwater kind of stuff.But in terms of the general training, we just keep training the whole film. So when we're not shooting, we're in the gym or we're in the fight studio or, you know, we're just keeping the skill sets fresh. And it's, so when we stop filming, we'll go and train. It's a lot of work to do on a Mission Impossible film set.
所以说您在演这个角色的时候，以您对这个角色的理解，他是更喜欢留在大本营里边去做一些技术的工作，还是愿意去到外面去，在一些比较危险的地方执行外勤？您觉得他更喜欢哪种状态？
I like being an agent, and I think that's what Benji wanted to be. You know, that's what he signed up for, and he's been out in the field since Ghost Protocol, the fourth Mission Impossible film. And each film since, he's found himself more in the action and more involved in what's going on. I'd like to see Benji grow further and, you know, I'd like to see him finish a fight. He's never finished a fight. He always gets saved by Ilse Faust, Rebecca Ferguson's character, which I don't mind. But I would like Benji just once to finish a fight himself.
你这个很多电影你都是扮演一个懂技术的人，你自己演的过程当中跟这个布袋跟这个原子弹折腾了很久，最后剪各种线呀，最后把它各种箱子里边拿出来，你现在你弄明白了它是个怎么个技术原理了吗？为什么要剪那些线？
I don't think I could defuse a nuclear bomb if I had to. No, I think if one needs to be defused, don't ask me. I just cut whatever's there. You know, you make it up. It's not real.
我看中文的时候，中文把这个布原子弹，它给翻成了一个布盒，这是翻译上的一个大 bug。应该准确的翻译应该翻译成布弹。而不是不合，我相信我们的观众看不懂的，他只有看了我们的节目，他才知道啊、哦，那是一个布弹。我们分铀弹、分布弹两种原子弹，布弹就是布239，就是当年1945年扔到长崎市的那个，扔下去以后70%的建筑物全都夷为平地，有将近40%的人死了，9万人就死了。这是一枚布弹，不到10公斤的一枚。但是翻译的时候，那上面那个字幕出的是不合。你现在搞明白了谁是拉克
？Yes，
但是我还不知道。
所以您在电影里饰演是一个很有趣的人，你在生活里也是这样同样的性格吗？跟这个角色一样的性格
？Oh, I think Benji is far more capable, and he's more of a superhero than I am. I mean, you know, as ordinary.As Benji is, he's still a secret agent, and he still has some great skills. And you know, he's very clever with electronics. And I'm not at all. So I mean, I'm a little bit like Benji, but I'm not a secret agent.
那如果下一步接着拍的话，您还会有什么新的突破吗？或者是你有什么新的想要在下一步里去尝试的吗？
Well, I'd like to see him grow again. You know, with every film we've done, he's grown as a person and as an agent. His skills have increased, and his bravery and his willingness to get involved in the action. I'd like to see Benji, you know, get his hands dirty and be in there with Ethan doing the big stunts. I think I'm ready.
可不可以给我们的粉丝说一句话吗？军武大本营。
Yes. What's it called again?
军武，
七五，七五，金武，你好，金武。